Welcome back to Paul's Tech News. It's June, which means we're staring straight down the barrel of summer 2025. And whether you're planning to hit the beach or lock yourself in a darkened room during the sunny season, you will at least be well informed of the previous week's progress in the world of tech thanks to your presumed interest in this show. I have returned, as the Dragoons say, in the nick of time, no less, as the very foundations of PC gaming were shook in recent days by a simple performance comparison that revealed just how much Windows sucks for gaming, if the alternative is SteamOS, that is. Also, RTX 5060 reviews have trickled in, showing why Nvidia was embarrassed enough to block them. Intel seems to still have plans to release an ARC B770 video card, and AI might start gobbling up the world's hard drives and SSDs now, as well as GPUs. It's almost time for my afternoon jet lag crash, so let's power through the tech news.
Excellent!
Today's video is brought to you by the Corsair Frame 4000D computer case, available in a variety of configurations thanks to the Frame modular case system. Customize your cooling with the InfiniRail fan mounting system, use removable panels to cover cables or mount fans to guide the Frame 4000D's high airflow pathways, or go for a clutter-free build thanks to reverse connector motherboard compatibility. There's also room for dual 360mm radiators and included GPU anti-sag support and easy IQ Link integration for RGB control and system monitoring. For more on the Corsair Frame 4000D, click the sponsor link in the video description. In a world where many of the things that used to be good now suck, it's always nice to have options. But when it comes to PC gaming, there's often no choice. Want the best GPU? Better be willing to pay $3,000 to Nvidia for an RTX 5090 that's riddled with problems. Just built a gaming PC? Well, you better install Windows then, just like I showed how to do in my tutorial recently, because it's the only viable operating system that's compatible with a wide range of games and hardware. But Windows is also riddled with problems, and for every one that's fixed, Microsoft seems to introduce more alongside their latest AI Copilot feature. So, when Dave2D posted this video 1 week ago comparing gaming performance on the same hardware, the Lenovo Legion Go S, which is now available for $130 cheaper with SteamOS, many were surprised at just how much a difference the operating system made, with games running 5 to 15% faster, and perhaps more importantly for a handheld, battery life getting a significant boost. The overall OS experience was also way better, with sleep functions working as intended, and none of the mysterious battery drain problems that Windows handhelds and laptops can encounter while not in use. SteamOS version 3.7 went live for the general public last week and now officially supports the Steam Deck and Legion Go S, but should also now run on other AMD-powered handhelds, which primarily means handhelds with the Ryzen Z1 and Z2 SoCs, but also, as shown by Jove's Gaming Lounge, also means you can install it on a desktop with an AMD GPU. Specifically, he ran a Ryzen 9 7900X and a RX 9070 XT. Now, to be clear, per Valve and Jove, SteamOS is still not a Windows replacement, or a Linux replacement for that matter, as many basic PC functions simply don't work as intended, and many gamers can't set it up right now at all simply because they have an Nvidia GPU at Nvidia market share coming back to bite them. But it does work. Random Gaming in HD also did some side-by-side testing where SteamOS improved performance in some games like Tomb Raider, Black Myth Wukong, and Forza Horizon 4, but performance was worse in Counter-Strike 2. If Valve continues to develop SteamOS and broaden hardware compatibility, as well as perhaps dropping in just a few more features for use on desktop, I think a lot of gamers will be glad to ditch Windows, especially if it means free performance. And Microsoft has likely noticed this development too. As of Friday, the rumored Xbox handheld has reportedly been delayed so they can shift focus to Windows 11's optimization for third-party handheld gaming PCs. Speaking of slowly dissolving PC hardware monopolies, Nvidia. Wishful thinking, I know, but since I have been vocal in my criticism of the RTX 5060 launch, what with the hand-picked reviews and lack of pre-launch drivers for independent benchmark testing, I was also quite curious to see what Nvidia was so keen to hide, or at least distract from, that they would burn up what little community goodwill they still have via such shenanigans. Hardware Unboxed managed to test the 5060 while still in Taiwan for Computex, and the 1080 averages show the 5060 outperforming the 3060 Ti and 6700 XT while not quite besting the 4060 Ti or 3070. At 1440, the 8GB VRAM limitation kicks in though, and all the lower ranked cards with more memory like the 12GB ARC B580 or the Radeon 6700 XT make up a ton of ground simply because they run out of memory less often. Jay also posted his review on Friday showing similar results. The 5060 shows passable 10 to 15% performance improvement over the last gen 4060 until it runs out of memory, at which point performance drops off pretty horribly. To be clear, again, for a lot of gamers who never encounter this, the 5060 will work just fine, even with 8 gigs of memory. So if you only play esports games or Counter-Strike or Fortnite or whatever, it's a functional card. But I think Daniel Owen's review did a good job of summarizing what you give up with a 5060. Looking specifically at the 8 titles he tested that came out this year, or I think within the last year, and even more specifically comparing 1% lows, which manifest as stutters during gameplay, all 8 games had major problems running on the 5060 at 1440, and 7 of the 8 struggled at 1080. If there was a reason for Nvidia to have done what they did, other than hubris or just deep-seated hatred for the PC gamers who built and supported their companies over the past 20 years, it was probably this. The 5060 cannot keep up with current PC gaming titles without major compromises. Of course, the criticism that I and others have directed at Nvidia lately and the recommendations to not buy 50 series GPUs have seriously impacted their sales and performance, and gosh, I bet they really regret their actions, except no, we didn't do that and Nvidia does not. Per their Q1 2026 financial results made public Wednesday, Nvidia is richer and more powerful than ever, with overall revenue up 69% giggity versus a year ago at $44.1 billion, and $39.1 billion of that is from data center, where that sweet, sweet AI money is. The earnings call also revealed that they're bringing 72,000 GB200 GPUs online each week in data centers. I can't verify, but that seems like maybe a few more than RTX 5090s that are being sold. But still, that is just staggering. And on the GeForce side of things, they also did quite well, showing how fruitless our recommendations to not buy 50 series GPUs have been. $3.8 billion, up 42% from last year, and yet still not enough to eclipse even the networking part of their data center revenue, where they made $4.9 billion. Great news for Nvidia stockholders, I suppose, but does anyone else benefit? Ah yes, Europeans, it seems, are catching the windfall this time. For where else but the green hills of Europe can one purchase an RTX 5090 for actually below MSRP? Certainly not here in the US. So yes, in case it wasn't clear, my suggestion is that Nvidia is subsidizing low RTX 5090 sale prices in Europe with its data center revenue, and I base this on absolutely nothing. Speaking of baseless GPU presumptions, Intel had a wide open window to pitch the Battlemage B770 during Computex, but they didn't, instead showing off some weird dual GPU workstation card that was sort of interesting, but definitely not an RTX 5060 or 5060 Ti alternative. Nevertheless, we are hopeful that a B770 will still be forthcoming because the B580 was a good GPU up until real-world pricing increased by 30 to 50% above MSRP. Tweakers.net apparently hit up sources close to Intel at Computex, and after those sources said they were all out of drugs, they settled for discussing some juicy B770 rumors instead. The B770 is apparently still in the works, coming in the second half of the year, which was further narrowed down to Q4 in the next sentence. Now by itself, this could be easily dismissed, given the vague time frame and the news source asking us over and over again if we're a cop while nursing an incessantly runny nose. But then on Wednesday, some telltale device IDs in a Linux Mesa graphics driver update uncovered by this guy revealed 4 new device IDs. 2 are likely for ARC Pro cards, but the 2 others are still unknown, although they have BMG in the name, which is almost certainly Battlemage. So don't give up hope on the B770 quite yet. But do give up hope on Intel's current LGA 1851 platform. Per a block diagram leaked by momomo_us on Friday, we apparently are in store for an Arrow Lake refresh before the socket gets kicked to the curb, as Intel is wont to do after, you know, 1 or 2 rounds with their current generation of processors. Like when your mom busts out last night's mediocre casserole, though, I doubt warming things over will make Arrow Lake any more palatable for gamers. Speaking of things that take too long, it's time for Tech Briefs, where the news goes too fast. If the 80 Plus Consortium Clear Result has gotten a little nervous about the introduction of other PSU rating systems like Cybernetics, this week's introduction of 80 Plus Ruby might be an indication. Except, it's for data centers. They just want some more of that AI money. But anyway, it's about time PSUs climbed out of the metal ranks, and with 96.5% efficiency required at minimum, this standard aims at near max power usage versus waste, which is kind of a big deal in the data center world. It also requires 90% efficiency at 5% usage, which is new for 80+. PSUs in this category will be behemoth 5,500 watt redundant units running on 230 volts or higher, but the bigger question is, of course, does the existence of 80 plus Ruby imply the existence of 80 plus Sapphire or 80 plus Diamond? I don't know. Along with Computex coverage last week, we had some updates on the ASRock AMD 9000 series CPU situation, which has claimed over 100 9800X3Ds as reported on Reddit. Follow-ups by Tech Yes City and Gamers Nexus got ASRock to basically say, yeah, our bad. Despite earlier excuses like suggesting the customers had gotten debris in the socket, ASRock's VP of motherboards, Chris Lee, now says they've rolled out BIOS version 3.25, which alters the PBO settings that were causing the problem. This was a bit of a niche issue given the limited number of users affected, but it was persistent, and I'm glad that after some pressure was applied, ASRock seems to have provided a solution. Now we just hope that this isn't like the Intel voltage problem solution last year, when it was fixed, and then fixed, and then fixed, and then fixed, and then fixed, and fixed, and finally, it was fixed. I think. Finally, we have yet another reason that AI sucks. Sure, it can write words for you and sometimes even complete sentences, but it can also generate AI slop artwork, and it can do so very quickly, and that AI slop needs to be stored somewhere, so now our data centers are filling with AI slop far too quickly. Now, humans manufacture 1 to 2 zettabytes of storage annually per Seagate, which is a fraction of projected data creation by AI. Now, one might think, perhaps we should generate less AI slop. But per Seagate, this is not a problem, really. The value of data has never been greater, driven by AI's ability to extract insights, said Colin Presley, Seagate's VP of Customer Engineering, who definitely didn't come up with that quote using AI. So when the storage prices skyrocket in the next year, just remember all that value that AI slop is creating for data centers. But that is pretty much all the value I have for you guys in this show. So there you have it, tech news for the weekend. If you liked it, maybe click that like button or leave me a comment down below. While you're down there, all of the articles that I talked about today are linked in the video's description if you're interested. And you can also check out my store at paulshardware.net for high quality merchandise like t-shirts, hoodies, beer sets, and more. Subscribing to my channel is always a good call too. Thanks again, everyone. It's good to be back. We'll see you next week.